friends. I hope you had a nice weekend and you had some time with your family. And I mean, we're all having lots of time with our family right now, but maybe even talk to some of your family from far away on the phone, or maybe did a video chat. I hope maybe the Easter Bunny came to your home, or maybe you went on an egg hunt. That would be fun. Yeah, and I hope you're having a good morning. You've done your stretches. You've washed your face, had some food, brushed your hair maybe, got some clothes on, and you're here for our lesson. So let's start by saying good morning to each other through our hearts and with our rainbow, with all of our friends. Always connected. I also hope you had some time to do some of the activities I talked about last Friday, last week, where we had the egg dyeing and maybe made some bunny crafts. Yes, I hope it's been a good time. I've missed you. All right, so let's start with the date. So today is still the month of April, and who knows what number it is. So when I saw you last on Friday, it was Friday, April 10th, and today it is Monday, April 13th. So I'm using this calendar today. I do have my other calendar, and I discolored this one a little bit. I'm getting there, you guys. Yeah, so let's do it together. It's Monday, April 13th, and we're almost halfway through our month. So that's pretty cool. It's going pretty quickly. And we're still very much in this season of, what season are we in? We are in the season of spring. Yeah, it's spring. And I don't know about you, but the weather here has been all over the place. We've had sun, we've had snow, we had hail, we had sleet, we've had wind, like strong, crazy wind. And then we've had sunny days. So who knows what is going on in Ottawa. That's what's happening here where I am, which is in Haliburton. And I have my weather jar here, and you can see that there's water in it. So yesterday when I looked at it and emptied it, there was a little bit. And then since that time, it snowed, then it rained, then overnight, I think it was just cloudy. And then this morning it's been sunny and windy. So my weather jar tells me all that because there are some pine needles in it and some tree dirt, if you can see. Also, there's water, so the snow would have melted, of course, and turned into water. And what was the other thing? Yeah, so after this, I'll empty it out and put it back outside. And oh yeah, that's right. So when I first grabbed it this morning, there was a thin layer of ice on top of it, and it's been inside now for probably about half an hour, so the ice on top has melted. It's just thin. Yeah, so it was also ice and loose water underneath, so it didn't totally freeze. It just freezed on the top layer, so it's interesting. Okay, so what I'm going to do is find the centimeters on my ruler, my shiny ruler, and yeah, I'm going to measure here, and I have exactly 1 centimeter, which is really neat because that's exactly 1 centimeter. So in my book, I'm going to write, April 13th, I put sun and wind, but since I'm recording the last 24 hours, I'm going to write that it was 1 cm, which stands for centimeters. So there, 1 centimeter of weather in my jar. Awesome. Okay. So, and I also hope you've been recording your birds that you've been seeing, maybe adding to your book quite a bit. So maybe you've done a few pages already, maybe you haven't, and that's okay. But hopefully you've seen some new birds, and maybe not new birds, but birds that you want to draw in here and you can add to it. And when you're out for walks, or if you see them in the flying, they don't have to be, you know, right in front of you standing there. They can be something that just flies by and you think, oh yeah, that's probably a seagull, or oh yeah, that's a robin, you know. And also maybe your bird feeder, maybe they've come to your bird feeders and had a little bit of the fruit. And with the finger puppets, you know, we kind of looked at some of the birds that we see in our backyards. So there's that too. Maybe you've seen one of those birds and you can write about that. All right, I hope it's going well. And just before we move into like our language and our math and talking about the animals and species we're talking about this week, maybe you already know, but I'll tell you soon. I just wanted to go over, you know, washing our hands again, taking care of our bodies, making sure that when we wash our hands, we sing a song to get all of the germs off and use lots of soap until it bubbles. The other thing that we've talked about in class, and I haven't mentioned it yet in the lessons, is our cough pocket or sneeze pocket. So I usually call it the cough pocket, but really it's for your coughs and your sneezes. So let's remember that. So when you, let's put on our arms. Hey guys. Okay, so you put your arms, you know, and you feel a cough coming. You want to make a pocket here. So you want to bend at your elbows and cough into your cough pocket. So you go, this is your cough pocket, and you have two of them, and you carry with them always, because even if you're wearing a t-shirt, you still can just cough into your cough pocket. And then of course you should wash your hands, you know, but at least your germs aren't going on your hands and then on the faucet and all over. So everybody has cough pockets, and you should use them all the time. Same if you feel a sneeze coming into your cough pocket, and your sneeze will be protected from going all over the place. Okay, so I hope you guys can all remember that, and it's fun because you have these two built-in pockets with you, and I know you're good at using them. All right, so quickly for French, we're just going to do how we're feeling today. I hope you're enjoying the French lessons, and yes, yeah, so we're just going to go aujourd'hui, ça va. So hopefully you chose one of them. Hopefully it was fantastique. And that's how your day is going today. All right, so this week we're talking about frogs. So as you know, we have our classification of things in the world. You know, we are, what are we? We're mammals. And last week we talked about birds. And this week we're talking about the category of amphibians. And then one of the species is frogs. And there are over 6,000 types of frogs. So I looked all over my house for, you know, frog pictures and books and things like that. And I really only have found this picture of a frog that was sort of, you know, correct. It has the right kind of parts to it. That's not just a silly drawing. This kind of does look like a real frog. I know a lot of you have done the frog puzzle in class. So we're going to kind of look at you know, what makes an amphibian, what kind of characteristics do they all share. We're going to look at the parts of a frog, we're going to look at the life cycle of the frog, and then later in the week we'll do some games and we'll do kind of our five senses as if we were a frog. So lots of things to explore with frogs, and I hope you start seeing some, you know, parts of the frog. Maybe you'll start seeing some tadpoles if you go to a marsh or a pond or a lake, and yeah, so we'll talk about it. Okay, so that is our frog. And let's make sure I just don't want to forget anything. Okay, so parts of the frog. So, as you know, frogs have a head, as you can see, a head, and they have a body. They have eyes on either side of their heads. They have nostrils. Okay, so we have nostrils and eyes and heads and bodies. But obviously, the frogs look really different than us. Excuse me. So also frogs have these amazing hind legs. So their back legs are super powerful, and that gives them the push to jump forward. And when we do our animal walks and you guys pretend to be frogs, I know you guys all understand how that push occurs to jump, to push forward. And they also use their legs for swimming. So the ones that swim underwater also definitely use their legs to swim. And also frogs have something cool. They have webbed feet. So they have this extra layer of skin in between their fingers or toes, and that helps them kind of paddle a larger surface of water. Also, like for tree frogs, when they're climbing, it gives them more balance and ability to climb. So they have webbed feet. And then they don't have ears like us that stick out of their head. They have a patch here behind their eyeballs called the tympanum. And that is like the hearing patch that ear patch, sort of like what birds have too, and allows them to hear sound if the predator's coming. So it's important. So they don't have ears that stick out, but they have this thing called the tympanum that allows them to hear. Okay, so those are kind of the main parts of the frog, and I'm going to send you a little activity you can print out and do, or you can just draw a frog, and label it. That's fun too, whatever you would like. And in terms of the species of amphibians, you know, there's lots of different types. There's like salamanders that are amphibians. They fall within that category. Lots of the different types of frogs. And frogs, you know, also appear all around the world. There's so much variation. Like I said, there's over 6,000 kinds. So the kinds that we're going to kind of look at this week are the ones that we find here in Ottawa and Canada and North America. And one cool thing about all amphibians is that they have these soft eggs. So, like we were looking at with birds, we looked at all their eggs, and all of their eggs have a calcified or kind of a hard shell. So they have to crack open. You have to break them if you're trying to open one. But frogs and amphibians, they have these soft eggs that kind of appear like jelly. They can be very, very small. They're sometimes translucent, which means see-through. So that's one cool thing that all amphibians share, is that their eggs are soft eggs. They don't have a hard shell. Another cool thing is that they all have permeable skin, so their skin is exactly reflective of where they are. So their environment, if it's, if it's moist in the rainforest, they're gonna have their skin's moist. In the water, their skin's wet. So they definitely have this moist, permeable skin all the time. So all amphibians have that. And another thing about amphibians that I actually didn't really remember, but it was fun to read about, was that all adult amphibians are carnivores. So all adult amphibians are eating bugs and insects and eating, worms, whatever they're after, water bugs, whatever feeds them, that is part of their food chain, and they're all carnivores. That was interesting. Yeah. All right, so we will look more at frogs tomorrow and throughout the week, and I will send you the parts of the frog to kind of work on and color if you would like. And yeah, let's move into our language lesson. Okay, so last week we did verb, noun, and adjective. It might have been over the last 2 weeks. So what we're going to do today is we're just going to practice the three of them, finding the three of them, thinking about the three of them. So the first thing we're going to do is we're going to draw our three symbols. Three symbols. So first, I'm going to show a verb. If you guys remember, for a verb we used a red circle. For the noun, we used a black triangle. And then for the adjective, we use the smaller blue triangle. Okay? So you can just draw it on a paper like me, like that. If you want with your ruler, you can add some lines, which would be nice. And maybe you have lined paper, so you could also just do this on top of lined paper. Those are kind of your categories. And then we're just gonna look, I want you to look at a book. So any book you have, any book you have at home, and I'm just going to choose the book that we did on Friday. I'm sorry, you can't see. And we're just going to look, and we're going to look for adjectives, verbs, and nouns, and we're going to write them into our categories. Okay, and maybe your goal should be to find five for each category. That would be really fun. Five, I think, is good. Okay, so here we go. All right, so in my mind, I have to remember before I even start, what is what? So a verb is an action word. A noun is what? Yeah, a person, place, or a thing. And an adjective is, something to describe the noun. It's a description word, okay? So if I'm looking in here right away, it says one day Jenny was putting. Ah, pudding. Well, that's a verb because she's doing an action. So, oh wait, and Jenny is definitely a noun because that's a person. Okay, great. So I already have two. So under noun, I'm going to write Jenny. And under verb, I'm going to put pudding. Okay. So I already have two. Yet, so she, sorry. One day, Jenny was putting yet another dirty. Huh. So is dirty a person, a place, or a thing? No. Is dirty a verb? No. Oh, so it's an adjective. So I'm going to put dirty under my adjective. So there, I already have first sentence, I already have one for each category. So it's putting another dirty glass. Glass is definitely a noun because it's a thing. Into the kitchen. That's a place. Sink. She looked. Ah, looking is a verb. out of the window at the bird feeder. Well, bird is definitely a noun. It's a thing. There we go. Okay, so I want you to do a text, a book, anything, one page of a book, two pages of a book, whatever you can, and try to get five for each. Also, maybe you're reading your sentence and you're just finding all verbs first, and then you're going to find all the nouns first, and then you're going to find all the adjectives first. So however which way you want to do it, okay? Yeah, and I think you guys will enjoy it and find lots of practice this way. And if you want to take a picture and show me, I would love it. If not, that's okay too. And tomorrow we'll move on to some different parts of for language and grammar. And later in the week, we're going to kind of take a break from grammar and we're going to work on this kind of frog book that I've set up for you. Okay, so I will show you that later in the week. Okay, so for math, I know you guys have all been working through your multiplication. I sent some questions, so I hope they're going well and you're enjoying using your multiplication table, multiplication square, chart, multiplication chart, your chart, multiplication chart. And so today I'm going to introduce some skip counting, okay? So skip counting is actually very closely related to multiplication. And in class, we count the beads, and that's really multiplying the numbers by themselves. So what we're going to do is start playing with our numbers to 100 using your skip counting. So you might want to use your 100 board for this, the 100 board that you made 2 weeks ago, or also you might just be able to do it in your head as well. And sometimes it will look just like the multiples of that. So the first one I wrote out today was skip counting of 5. So I wrote 5, 10, 15. So as I can see, like right here, is that my numbers are increasing by 5, right? So I have 5, and then I had 10, then I have 15. So if I'm adding 5 more to 15, I'm going to go 16, 17, 18, 19, 20. Yeah, so 5 more to 15 gives me 20. So there I write 20. And then I still have 2 more spaces to fill. So then 5 more than 20 is going to give me 21, 22, 23, 24, 25. 5 more, 25. And then 5 more than 25, 26, 27, 28, 29, 30. Yeah. So there, I did a number, kind of a number chain, by going by counting by 5s. Okay, so 5, 10, 15, 20, 25, 30, and we keep going 35, 40, 45, etc. Okay, and this one down here, it says 2, and then I have 4, and then I have 6. So how are these increasing? Well, if I have 2, and I go 3, 4, oh, so they're increasing by 2, all right? So I know 2, 4, 6, okay, so I'm going to count here 7, 8, that's 2 more, gives me 8. Okay, after 8, 9, 10, gives me 10 more, or 2 more, gives me 10. And then 11, 12, 2 more gives me 12. So here I'm counting by 2s. So I'm skip counting by 2s. Awesome. Okay, now the bottom one here I wrote says 10, 13, 16. Okay, so what is it increasing by? If I have 10, and then I have 13, it's increased by how many? So let me count on my fingers. So I'm going to go 11, 12, 13. Ah, it's increased by 3. Let me make sure. So then I have 13 to 16. So it goes 14, 15, 16. Yeah, okay, so the difference between 10 and 13 is 3. The difference between 13 and 16 is 3. So now I need to count 3 more than 16. So I'm going to go 17, 18, 19. Right. So I'm counting by 3s, 19. Okay, I have another space here. So 3 more, 20, 21, 22. Yeah, so I skip counted another 3, and then it gives me 22. And then 3 more, 23, 24, 25. There we go. So I'm skip counting by 3s there to finish my chain. Okay, so I sent you some sheets to do at home, and if you don't want to print them out, you can just write out and just choose a couple to do, or do the whole page of skip counting. It's really good to practice. It's good for your brain, it's good for your number sense, and it's good for recognizing your patterns in multiplication. Last little math thing, which we're going to do more geometry and more geometric solids and get into our shapes and things like that. But I was showing this to the first years, and I also showed it to the second years today in the lessons. And I just wanted you guys to also have the opportunity to do this because it's really fun. And I miss being in class and I miss the materials. And this is a cool one I found where you get to make the pink tower at home. So I thought you guys would like that. So basically, you just color all the, what shapes are these? Cubes, yeah, color all the cubes, and then you can build the pink tower at home, and maybe even you can stick it on the wall and have it go vertically up like the pink tower would in class. So you can take the biggest cube on the bottom and work your way to the smallest cube at top, and it's just a fun kind of classroom activity. There's 10 of them, of course, and they all change in one diameter per cube, so that's cool too. But yeah, I think it's just fun, so I wanted to give that to you guys to do. And I know the pink tower in class is always pink, but you can obviously color your pink tower at home any color you want, or you can color all different colors. It could be a rainbow pink tower, and it's still the pink tower because that's how it works. So enjoy it. I hope you like it. And what was I gonna do? Oh yeah. Okay, so I wanted to do this little frog poem with you, and just because it was cute and fun, and I know you guys are big, you're my big third years, but it's still fun to do poems and things, and so we'll do a few this week. So this one is about a little frog named Tiny Tim. So I have a little frog, his name is Tiny Tim. I put him in the bathtub to see if he could swim. He drank up all the water, he gobbled up all the soap, and when he tried to talk, he had a bubble in his throat for a There you go, little poem. Okay, and then the very last thing is that today we're looking at how to use a hanger. So I just brought a medium-sized hanger that I use for some of Sloane's clothing. And maybe you have a big hanger, maybe you have your hallway hangers, maybe you have wood ones. So I just chose this one. And I'm sure you all know how to do this because, again, you're big third years. But in case, I thought we could practice together just a little bit. So when you're going to hang something up, you want to look for the neck hole. Okay, so I have this little dress of Sloane's, and I'm looking for the neck hole. Okay, and if I just try to jam the hanger like in it all like this, I'm going to stretch out the neck of the garment, and then it's going to be loose and maybe it'll fall off the hanger. So what I want to do when I have my hanger and my garment, I want to place half of my hanger into the armhole and then lightly stretch the other side over like that to place it on the hanger. Okay, so again, you can't really just put like both sides in at the same time. You can't go through the arm. You want to put one side and then the other side, and there you go on your hanger. Okay, so then more complicated, but definitely something. I know that when you're coming in from outside right now, you might be a little bit muddy, or dirty. So here we have, a sweater. You have your muddy buddies probably. You have your raincoats, whatever it is. And basically, you want to practice hanging your coats and things on hangers. So your coat will either have zippers or buttons. And I think the best thing to do is to zip it up at the bottom. So we're practicing zipping the other day. So you're going to zip it up, and you're going to zip it up just about the chest level of the jacket. So about here. Okay, and then you're going to stick your hanger in just the same way we were just doing it. So sticking it into the armholes, one side and the other side. And then you want to pull up your zipper or do up the last button so that it sits nicely and stays on the hanger. Okay, because if we leave it zipped down, eventually it's going to maybe pull off and then fall on the ground, and then we have wet things and they're not hanging and it's dirty and our grown-ups don't like it. So we want to practice putting it on the hanger and then finishing the zipping up or the button up or the snap, okay? And then that will make it stay really nicely on the hanger, and you can put it in your hallway closet or wherever you hang your things. Alright, so I hope you enjoyed that, and I hope you practice it at home and have fun with your skip counting and finding your adjectives and your nouns and your verbs. I know you guys can all do that. And yeah, so I'm going to say bye to all my friends under the rainbow. I miss you all, and I'll see you guys all soon. And tomorrow we'll have more fun lessons. And bye from me to you. And yeah, have a great day.